Welcome to Stephen Johnson Stocks, the most transparent motherfucking trader in the world, showing his entire journey week by week from day one, which can be a blessing and it can be a curse. The blessing is I've had super cool privileges. I've got to interview really awesome people. I've got to hang out with Tim Bourne a lot and got to know Tim Sykes better. The curse is that when I take bad losses, my journey's in public. Now, I will take that curse any day of the week, because the great thing about this is I'm teaching you guys for free and you're learning through me. And now as I become a more intermediate trader, all of the lessons that come, you will see. Now, just to get it out, I took a $5,000 loss, then got frustrated and took another $2,000 loss. I had basically, from February, I put $25,000 of my own money into an interactive broker's account. I turned that $25,000 into $32,000 in just 4 or 5 months. And then in 4 days, I lost the entire $7,000 and I'm right back to my $25,000. At worst, I think I might have lost about $200 of the original investment that I put in. And I've lost 5,000 of profits, 7,000 of profits, or 6,000 of profits. And it's, for me, there's three phases in trading. First, you lose all the time. Then you make money and give it back. Then you get consistently profitable. And I was thinking, well, will I ever reach the third phase? Because this is the second time I've took $5,000 losses. And of course, there's been, I lost the 5,000 a week ago, and there's a reason why I'm making this video a bit later, and it's because I've just been thinking about it. I've thought about it in bed, I've thought about it off the balcony, I went camping, I've thought about it in the middle of the fucking desert. And I thought, Stephen, if you can't take these losses, then you have to quit, because your wins are $500 to $1,000, but your big losses are $4,000 and $5,000. So if you cannot take these losses and they're going to keep on building up, then you have to quit, because I am not living this risky, uncertain life. I'm just not doing it. I don't want to do it. Even if I make other people's money and lose it, I'm just not doing it. It's too fucking high and low and depressing. So I thought, if I can't control the losses, then I quit. And then I thought, well, think about it a bit more. And the truth is, I can't. I can't take the losses, and I don't know if I ever will be. I don't know if I can take a $2,000 loss. I don't know if I can take a $3,000 loss when I'm only making $1,000. Maybe if I'm making $10,000 in trades, then I can take a $5,000 or $10,000 loss. But when I'm only making $500 to $1,000 and my monthly profits are only $3,000, I cannot take a $3,000 loss. It's too psychologically bad for us. And then I thought, well, I have to quit because I can't take the losses. And I thought about it more, and I thought, well, how do you avoid getting yourself in the positions? Because it's easy to say, oh, I'm just down 200, then, oh, if I'm at down 500, I'll just cut it. But I don't. I'll be down 500 and I'll just let it go to 7 and then 8 and then 1,000. Like, I can't work on numerical losses. I can't be like, oh, 500's my limit. I struggle with that. 500 I'm okay with, 800 I'm okay with. 1,000 to 1,200, I'm okay at, I can cut them. But anything over 1,500, I freeze and I can't cut it. I just can't. And then it goes 2, 3, 4. So I thought, well, I have to quit then because I'm not a good enough trader. I don't have the discipline. And then I thought, well, what happened when I took the first loss that is similar to when I took the second loss? And it really just clicked in the last day or two. Both times you averaged up into a loser. And for me, averaging up and down and managing position size was the privilege of having a bigger account. And Dux does it and Grittani does it. So I thought, if they do it, then I can do it. But the problem is Dux and Grittani can cut $3,000 losses and $4,000 losses, but I can't. So then I thought, well, how do I make it so I never get in the position that I'm in a $3,000 or $4,000 loss situation again? Because when you're averaging up, as you'll see in this trade, say you're in $3,000 and you're down 10%, then you're only down $300. That's easy to get out of. But for me, when I'm down 10% on a $3,000 position, I'll double up, average up, double up, average up. Before I know it, I'm in $15,000 and I'm 20% down, and I'm down like fucking $1,000 or $1,500 or whatever. And with AQMFS or AQFM or whatever it was, the first $5,000 loss, the problem that I had is I averaged up and I averaged up and I averaged up. And the problem with ADOM is when I took the trade, first of all, I took it with fear of missing out and I shortened near support, but that's not the big problem. The problem is I averaged up, it broke higher day, I averaged up. And then before I knew it, I was in $40,000 and I was down 10%. And then, yeah, you're gonna take a $5,000 loss. So maybe, just maybe, I cannot I cannot cover a short when I'm 1,500 down, 200 down. But what I fucking can do is not add to a short when the initial short doesn't work. I cannot press that button. And this is where the difference lies. Maybe I cannot cover a short, but I can damn fucking sure not add to one, if that's a rule. So that's the rule. And honestly, I've proven to you guys once, I can make money when everyone said I couldn't, got profitable. Took the loss averaging up on a short, lost it. Made it all back, got profitable a second time, then took another loss, but I didn't realize what the fucking key mistake was. I didn't realize that I was losing because I was adding to a short and I couldn't cut the loss. It sounds simple, but you need to go through the journey to make these realizations and self-discoveries about yourself. And now that I fucking know this, I've got a rule. I am not adding to a short at all, period, for at least 2 weeks. If I cannot take a loss of about $500 and I don't add to any shorts, then I'll say, fine, you have one fucking ad, one. So factor it into a plan. And if I have one ad and then I start taking anywhere near $500 losses, you're going straight fucking back to no ads because you can't fucking use them properly. And if I do this, doubt me again, doubt me that I will fail. I can tell you, I know patterns, I know theory, I can crush it in the market. The only problem is I've been adding to shorts and it's been causing us to take big losses. I say if I fix this, third time lucky, I'll be profitable. Let's talk more at the end. Let's get into the trade. So here is the kind of the background, and no wrongs for the rest of the month was a rule. I was very good at taking it. Trade 2, pattern sold green, I was very good. I was making a lot of money. Only trade the first 2 hours, I was very good. I kept all these rules. This rule is the only rule that I can't seem to keep. And that's why I've implemented a new rule, which is no averaging up. And if I don't average up, the only way to take a 500 loss is if I take a 10% loss on a 5 grand position. If I'm not allowed to average up, I can bet you that I'm going to cut that loss. But otherwise, going through the kind of trades, I took this kind of 5,000 loss in, it was February 5th. And since that loss, I was green week. Through February until March, and I was green week, made $2,700 in March, which was sweet. And then in April, it was a bit slower, but like red week, green week, made $1,200. And then I was getting up to $1,000 weeks, and it's typical when you accelerate, you have a crash, 500 week, 1,000 week, 1,000 week, and then boom, I crashed. And I think this is a little bit wrong. Obviously, I've took a 4,000 loss, and this is a, what's it? No, that's probably right. So yeah, I mean, the value is minus nothing, but really I'm down about six, seven grand. And the answer for me is stop averaging up. You can have these very consistent days, all green days, no losses, all green days. All I need to do to be successful is don't average up, don't let the losses get too big. Because if you don't average up, then you can keep them 500, 600, and you have no trouble cutting $500, $600 losses. Cut a $1,300 one here, cut a $1,400 one here, cut a $700 one here, cut a $300 one here. The minute it gets over $1,500, then boom, it goes to $5,000. Now, ADOM is tough because, I mean, I was obviously right on the short. This is a strategy that I track a lot. It's a strategy that I follow a lot. When you get this big overextension, generally you'll get a small pop at the open and then it will fail and this will be the red day. Turned out a few days later, I was back in the ones. I was shorting it in the kind of the twos, so it was kind of banking 100%. But you've got to kind of accept that every now and then, for whatever reason, you're going to have insane volume. Whoops, I'm putting vertical bars on. For whatever reason, you've got to accept that there's going to be insane volume. And there was 32 million. And generally what happens in these kind of trades is say on the first day there was 10 million volume. The next day there'll be about 5 million volume. Everyone's taking profits from the gap up from the first day. And the sellers outweigh the buyers and the stock goes down. It has a little push, but then it drops. On this day, for whatever reason, had insane volume, significantly higher than the day before, and it pushed the stock up, which caused the squeeze and more buyers. But ultimately it did end up where it was. Now, my problem with this is, yeah, I mean, obviously I was right overall, but it doesn't matter. Like,
When you're early on a short, and there's no excuses. So we had this kind of, I'll have to go back about 10 days. I'm trying not to look at charts right now, because I want to take a break. But we had this kind of first push, and then we had the big strong gap up, and I was shorting here, thinking it was about to crack and break down. But what ended up happening is we had this kind of squeeze, and mean, I can talk you through it. I was starting shorting here, shorting here, shorting a little bit here, then when I pushed, I shorted a fair amount, and ideally, what I should have done is waited for the spike out of the gate. And say, for example, it's opening in the 150s, you're shorting in the 160s, 170s, and when it gets there, it just gets there. So you're taking a short in the 160s, 170s, it comes back down, take some profits in the 150s, and you cut the rest higher day. This is what I've preached in the DVD guide that I sold. I didn't follow my own rules. And that's the other thing about the DVD. Like, someone said to us, how can you be selling a guide when you're losing? I'm like, because I'm not selling a fucking. What I'm selling is the fucking hard mathematical evidence of how to find an edge in the market and how I found a proven edge. It's not a fucking trade like fucking Jeevan guide. It's not like a, yeah, here's how you don't cut your losses guide. It's a fucking mathematical guide on how to track data, how to find an edge, proven mathematical formulas of how you find an edge, proof of charts of where the edge exists, and when you should kind of cut your losses and how you should size in. So I'll still sell the guide. I'm not disappointed about it. I'm not proud of it. I'll never take it back. And to the one person who said that, like, fuck you, seriously. It's about learning, and everyone liked it, and everyone loved the guide. But again, I played this by averaging up, averaging up. Didn't take profits down here, averaged up, and then got cut out in the 190s. Ideally, what I would be doing in the future, say I've got one average and that's it, then I'm not shorting here. Or say I do short here and I've got one average, I've got no averages up. When it starts to pick up, I think, well, I have to cut it because I'm red on the trade and I can't average up again. Then get back in on the spike, new pattern, new chart. Take some profits down in here. You've got about 5% from the 170s to the 150s, or even 8%, 9%. And then when it runs higher, you've got to cut it. And that's the way I would take the trade, because the problem is I'm averaging up here, I'm averaging up here, I'm averaging up here, I'm averaging up here, and then I'm cutting it. And I'm in 50,000 shares and it's moving 3-4% at a time. But if you just take one shot, even for example, even you take one shot, 5,000, say you've got $10,000 position in the 170s. When it gets to the 180s, 190s, say you're down 10% on, I don't know, what would say you've took $10,000, you're down 5%, 6%, you're down $600, and you're thinking, shit, I've got to cut this. But ultimately, I mean, you'd get away with it. You should cut the $500 loss, but ultimately, you'd get away with it. But if you're shorting here, averaging up, averaging up, averaging up, when it spikes, yeah, you're down 5 grand. And that's the difference in discipline that I need to realize. I need to think, right, short, take your chance if you want to short it here. But if it pops up on you, you can't add, so get out and see if it spikes at the open. And if it washes at the open, then it's your own fault because you are early. But it's better to miss and lose $50 and lose the opportunity than lose 5 grand.
Now, I just want to end this video by kind of answering some of the comments that I'm already going to get. Now, a lot of people are already ready to jump on the bandwagon and say, Stephen, you failed. Trading is not for you. You're too much of a gambler. You're too mature. And all the other stuff. And I just want to answer it now, so you guys can hopefully, a lot of people are writing negative comments. Have you seen a one-legged dog? Then you seen me. A lot of the times, I'm trying to make people understand, but I just don't have the time to just write the same thing. Come and stand at every door. You've seen me. So always leave kind of with less than I had before. And you've seen me, but I can make you smile when the blood hits the floor.
I don't mean education in math, science, and physics. I mean, they're not kind of brought up well, or maybe they're a little bit neglected. And I'm not channeling this at anyone, I'm just saying it as a fact. And if someone constantly gets the negative kind of affirmation that they might not be good enough, then it can be self-destructive later on in life. And then you can have lack of confidence, lack of self-esteem.
And then the minute you try something and it doesn't work, you're like, oh, this is never going to work. You look for the negatives. Oh, this is a scammer. Oh, well, if I can't do it, no one can do it. And you see a lot of the negatives. And then when you see someone else trying to do it, you think, oh, well, it's impossible. I can't do it. So you'll never do it. But the reality is, I mean, God bless me, mom and dad, Bill and Viv, love you guys a lot. I kind of grew up with a lot of positive affirmations and they're like, you can be whatever you want to be. And I was never the most like clever kid, but, and I was also a bit reckless and stupid and drinking and all that stuff. But those said, like, and I'll never forget when I was at high school, me high school teachers was like, you'll not go on to university. He's not bright enough. And my parents are like, no, you can do whatever you want. So I worked and worked and worked. Might have worked harder than other people, but in the end, I got very good high school grades, like very good, much better than expected. Went on to do a degree in English. And everybody told us, your writing style is terrible. I think you should probably quit. So what I did is I wrote and wrote and wrote and practiced and practiced and practiced. And then all of a sudden, I graduated with one of the highest level degrees you can graduate with, like nearly first class. The English people will know, the Americans won't. And then when I got a job, I pretty much got forced out of the first company that I worked for because I wasn't good enough. But when I got fired, the loathers, the bad people, the people without the positive self-esteem would have been like, oh, okay, I'm just going to get a job in a dead-end call center because I failed, but not me. I'm like, no. Why did you fail? Because your writing isn't strong enough, again. How can you make it better? Read loads of blogs, journals, articles, practice your writing, write, guest write for other people's blogs, network with good communicators, find out what they do that's good. And then I got a job in an advertising company, and now I will see it for effect, but I'm not doing bad. I mean, I'm living in Dubai, working for a top advertising agency, leading a content team. My apartment has the best view of the Palm that you can get in Dubai and the Burj Al Arab, and I've got 30 grand in the bank. So with trading, it's the same, and there's a difference between the doers and the don'ters. The doers will think, what did I do wrong? They will not self-loathe. They'll think, how can I fix it? What did I do wrong, which I repeated? What mistake do I not need to make again? For me, it's averaging up because I can't take the loss. And then it's just repeating the process again and again and again and again. And while some people might learn faster, well, Grittani, Dux, Roland, Sykes might nail it straight away. Maybe I am not as genetically gifted as these people, but I do know the formula for success. It is ingrained in my DNA. How you fucking take the steps to get successful. I have the self-esteem and self-respect and self-determination and know I just need to fix this and this and this, and then I'm gonna fucking run with it. And you've called me delusional once and I got profitable. You've called me delusional again and I got profitable again. I fucking dare you. I fucking dare you call me delusional again. I will write down your name and I will write it. When I make new highs, not just profitable, but when I'm up 2, 3, 4 grand, I will read out your names and say, you, my friend, are a fucking daunter. Because I know the formula for success, and I've achieved it all my life. Through repeating the same formula, this is why Tayo Cruz makes fucking millions. And he can apply it to any industry because it's a simple process of working, failing, analyzing what went wrong, working again, failing again, analyzing what went wrong, and just having the self-esteem and self-confidence and self-determination to work harder than any other motherfucker to get to the next level. And I'll see you back at the top. I'll see you there. Haters, comment your hate. I will screenshot the comments and I will write it back when I'm at the top. You motherfuckers. For those of you who've supported us, please comment. Still supporting you, Jeevan. It really helps lift me. I'm a human. I have naturally low periods when I've been losing. But we are in this dream together. We're in it from the start. We'll be in it together for the future. And I believe that I've finally found the crux that has stopped me from being successfully profitable this whole time. So for me, praise Jesus. Alhamdulillah. I found the fucking flow in me trading. Now let's make some money.